السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهدي الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالًا كثيرًا ونساءً، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدى هدى محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. ثم معاشر الإخوة والأخوات، أبدأ كلامي في مجالسنا هذه في هذه المجالس العلمية التي تقام في دولة بريطانيا بترحيب واعتذارين. أما الترحيب فأرحب بجميع الإخوة والأخوات بترحيب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم، حيث جاءه صفوان بن عسال رضي الله عنه فقال: يا رسول الله، جئتك أطلب العلم. فقال صلى الله عليه وسلم: مرحبا بطالب العلم، إن طالب العلم تحفه الملائكة بأجنحتها، ثم يركب بعضهم بعضا حتى يبلغ السماء الدنيا من محبتهم لما يطلب. قال العلماء: عدل النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم عن قوله مرحبا بك أو مرحبا يا صفوان إلى قوله صلى الله عليه وسلم مرحبا بطالب العلم، ليكون هذا الترحيب ترحيبا بكل طالب علم أخلص لله سبحانه وتعالى. فمرحبا بالجميع في طريق من طرق الجنة، وما أجمله من طريق، وما أوسعه من طريق. طريق أوله في الدنيا وآخره في الجنة. قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: من سلك طريقا يلتمس به علما سهل الله له به طريقا إلى الجنة. فمن سلك طريقا من بعيد أو قريب فهو يسير في طريق الجنة. قال العلماء: طلب العلم طريق للجنة من جهتين. الجهة الأولى أن المسلم يعرف بالعلم طريق الجنة. وكيف يسير في الطريق من لا يعرف؟ فلا بد من العلم حتى يسير الإنسان على هدى وبصيرة. والجهة الثانية أن طلب العلم يحبه الله سبحانه وتعالى، فهو بذاته لمن أخلص لربه طريق موصل إلى الجنة. مرحبا مرحبا بالإخوة والأخوات في الأجور العظيمة والمقامات الكريمة. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال: من غدا إلى المسجد ليتعلم خيرا أو يعلمه كان له كأجر حاج تاما حجته. من ذهب إلى المسجد، قال العلماء: ولا خصوصية للمكان، فإن الفضل معلق بالعمل. يعني لا خصوصية للمسجد، ذهب إلى مسجد، ذهب إلى قاعة، ذهب إلى مدرسة، لكنه ماذا يريد؟ ليتعلم خيرا، والخير هو العلم الصحيح. ليس كل ما يعلم خيرا، فبعض ما يعلم شر، وإن سمي علما وإن نسب إلى الدين. العلم ما بني على كتاب الله وعلى سنة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم، وجاء عن صحابة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. فمن غدا وذهب ليتعلم خيرا أو يعلم خيرا فله أجر الحاج الذي تم حجه، كأنه ذهب إلى مكة وأدى الحج مبرورا تاما، والحج المبرور ليس له جزاء إلا الجنة. الله أكبر يا إخوة. من أخلص لله في هذا المقام الذي نحن فيه يفوز بأجر الحاج الذي تم حجه بدون كلفة الحج. وأما المقامات الكريمة فقد قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: وما اجتمع قوم في بيت من بيوت الله يتلون كتاب الله ويتدارسونه بينهم إلا نزلت عليهم السكينة وغشيتهم الرحمة وحفتهم الملائكة وذكرهم الله في من عنده. الله أكبر، ما أعظمه من مقام. ما اجتمع قوم في بيت من بيوت الله، أقول ما قلت سابقا، قال العلماء: لا خصوصية للمكان، بل متى ما اجتمع المسلمون بإخلاص لله في مكان يتعلمون الخير، يتلون كتاب الله ويتدارسونه بينهم، هذا قيد في العلم، أنه لا بد أن يكون هذا العلم مبنيا على كتاب الله، على سنة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم، كما كان السلف يفعلون. إلا نزلت عليهم السكينة، ينزل عليهم ربهم من السماء سكينة تحل في قلوبهم. ومن طمأن الله قلبه ما الذي يخيفه؟ الله ينزل سكينة عليه. قال العلماء: وهذه السكينة تكون في قلبه، تكون في بيته، تكون في حياته، من أراد الطمأنينة فعليه بالعلم السلفي الأصيل. وغشيتهم الرحمة فغطتهم من جميع جوانبهم، وحفتهم الملائكة، أحاطت بهم الملائكة. ثم يركب بعضهم بعضا حتى يبلغ السماء الدنيا من محبتهم لطلب العلم. جلساؤهم الملائكة الذين لا يعصون الله ما أمره، فتفر الشياطين من هذا المجلس. ثم يأتيك الشرف الأعظم، وذكرهم الله في من عنده. لا يذكرون عند ملك من ملوك الدنيا. ولو قيل لإنسان إنك إذا فعلت كذا ذكرت عند الرئيس أو عند الملك لحرص على هذا العمل، فكيف إذا قيل له إن الملك سيذكرك؟ الملك بنفسه سيذكرك، لا شك أنه سيكون أحرص. والله إن المقام هنا أشرف، لأن الذي يذكرك هو الله. الله يذكرك، نعم والله، إن أخلصت له وطلبت علما نافعا، والله 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 إن الله يذكرك. يذكر عبده فلانا، أين؟ في من عنده، في الملائكة. الله أكبر، والله إنه لشرف لو علمت به الملوك لجالدون عليه بالسيوف. الأمر فقط يحتاج منا إلى أمرين: إخلاص لله وانتقاء للعلم. لا تجالس كل أحد، ولا تستمع لكل ما يقال. نقي سمعك، نقي قلبك من قاذورات الأفكار التي تسمى علما وهي ليست بعلم، وأخلص لربك. تنل هذا المقام الشريف. لا أريد أن أطيل في هذه النقطة، لكني أحببت أن أرحب بإخواني جميعا في بداية هذه المجالس.
The Shaykh حفظه الله تعالى started first and foremost with the خطبة الحاجة. Then the Shaykh said, here we are together in gatherings of knowledge. This is the first gathering, inshallah, from the gatherings of knowledge to come in Britain. So the Shaykh said, I would like to start with first welcoming you and then two apologies. So first and foremost, the Shaykh said, here I welcome everyone. I welcome all my brothers and sisters who have come to attend this conference and benefit. And the Shaykh, he mentioned the hadith of Safwan ibn Asal radiallahu an, who came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he said, I've come to you to gain knowledge, to seek knowledge. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam replied and said, welcome to the student of knowledge. Welcome, O student of knowledge. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam continued and he said, as for the students of knowledge, those who are seeking knowledge, then the angels, they surround them with their wings until they they go in layers, in levels one above another. They continue to do this until they reach the lowest heaven. Due to them loving, due to their love of that which is being sought. So here the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when Safwan ibn Asal radiyallahu anhu came to him, he did not say to him, marhaban bik. He did not specify him and say to him, welcome to you. Or welcome Safwan. But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam left it general and he said, marhaban bi talib al-ilm. So this is, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam here is welcoming every student of knowledge, male or female, who is sincere, who is sincerely seeking knowledge for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Shaykh Hafidhahullah, he continued, and he said, I welcome all of those who are attending, and I give them the glad tidings of a path from the paths of Jannah. And the Shaykh said, what a beautiful path this is. First of it, at the beginning of this path, is in this life, in this worldly life. And the end of this path is in Jannah. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, whoever treads a path seeking Jannah, seeking knowledge, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make a path to Jannah, to paradise, easy for him. So the Shaykh said, so whosoever has treaded this path, whether he's come from a place that is close or from far, then he is traversing this path to Jannah. And the scholars, they have mentioned that seeking knowledge is a path to Jannah from two angles. Firstly, when a Muslim, he gains knowledge, and by way of this knowledge, he knows which path it is that leads to Jannah. The Shaykh said, how can someone traverse a path which he has no knowledge of? So this, when he gains knowledge, a person he knows, he can tread this path, the path of guidance with insight and knowledge. And second angle, the talab al-ilm, seeking knowledge, is an act which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he loves. So seeking knowledge in itself, for the one who is sincere, it is a path, it is something, or it is a path that will lead him to Jannah. And the Shaykh said that seeking knowledge has tremendous rewards and lofty stations. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, whosoever goes to a masjid to learn some good or to teach some good, then he has the reward of someone who has performed a complete and perfect Hajj. And here when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, whosoever goes to a masjid, the scholars have mentioned here, this does not specifically just apply to mosques. Any place, whether that's a mosque, or some kind of a hall, or a center, or a school, Whosoever goes to these places with the intention of learning good, and good, when we say something good here, is the correct knowledge. The Shaykh said that not everything that is taught is good. In fact, some of what is being taught is evil, and it is bad. Even though it might be called ilm, knowledge, but it's evil. And it's being attributed to the deen. So even though some people might call it knowledge and attribute it to the deen and ascribe it to the deen, to the religion, it is still evil. And the Shaykh continued, Hafidhahullah, and he said, so therefore ilm, the correct knowledge, that which is based upon the book and the sunnah, and upon that which the Sahaba radiallahu anhum came with. So whosoever he goes to a place to learn some good or teach some good, then he gets the reward of performing a complete and perfect Hajj. So he does not need to go to Mecca. So it is like he's going to Mecca and he's performed a Hajj which has been accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's Hajj Mabrur. The reward for Hajj Mabrur, the one that's been accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is nothing except Jannah, paradise. So whosoever in this place today, has come here sincerely for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then he gets the reward of Hajj, perfect and complete Hajj, without actually even going to Mecca. And as for the maqamat karima, the noble and lofty status and station of gaining knowledge, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, there are no people who come together in a house from the houses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, reciting the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, studying it, revising it, except the sakina, tranquility descends upon them, mercy encompasses them, the angels surround them, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he mentions that person in the heavens, in the presence of those who are with him, the angels. Again here, the Shaykh said, the ulama, they've mentioned, the scholars have mentioned, in this hadith likewise it says, there's no people who come together in a house from the houses of Allah. Again, there is no, this is not specific to just mosques, any place. As long as the Muslims, they come together with ikhlas, with sincerity, in any place, reciting, studying, teaching the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this here, the Shaykh said, here a point of benefit, that these people, what are they doing? They are studying and teaching the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the ilm, this is the knowledge which is based upon the book and the sunnah. This is what the Salaf of this Ummah used to do. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He will send our Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala, he will send sakina, tranquility upon you, upon us from the heavens. He will send down tranquility upon your hearts. So a person whose heart Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made tranquil and peaceful, And how is he going to fear anything? And the ulama, they said that this sakina, this tranquility and peace, this will be placed in your hearts, in your houses, throughout your entire life. So whosoever wants peace and tranquility, then he must gain the correct knowledge, the knowledge of the Salaf. And also, غَشْيَةٌ وَرَحْمَةٌ. Rahma, it surrounds them from all sides. And likewise, the angels, the noble angels, they surround them until they go one layer above another level, one level on top of one level, on top of another level. That's how many angels they are until they reach the lowest heaven. So your companions in such gatherings are the angels who do not disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In a gathering of this sort where the angels are present, the devils, they flee. And the greatest honor that is mentioned in this hadith for those seeking knowledge, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will mention you in the presence of those who are with him. The Shaykh Hafidahullah, he said, just let's take an example. If you were to know that a king or a certain ruler is going to mention you, or you actually you are going to be mentioned in his presence, then you will strive to do everything to make sure that happens. In fact, how about if you found out that you are not going to be mentioned in his presence, but rather he himself is going to mention you? And of course, you are now going to be even more keen and more eager. And you're going to strive your utmost to make sure that happens. However, the Shaykh Hafidahullah said, but here, it's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the true king, who is going to mention you. If you are sincere and you are gaining beneficial knowledge and the correct knowledge, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to mention you where? He's going to mention you in the presence of the angels. The Shaykh said, this is indeed honor. This is true honor and true nobility. The Shaykh said that if the muluk, the rulers and the leaders were to know about this, then they would strike us swords. But the Shaykh said, these are the conditions, that you have ikhlas, you are sincere to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that the knowledge that you gain is pure. Don't sit with everyone and anyone. Don't listen to everyone. Protect and purify your heart and your hearing and your seeing from what enters that, from what enters through your hearing, what enters through your eyes and your sight into your heart. Purify it and protect it and be sincere.
هذا الترحيب. أما الاعتذاران فالأول اعتذار عن التغير الذي طرأ على الدورة من جهة بدايتها ومن جهة عدد أيامها، حيث كان المحدد أن نبدأ الدورة يوم الخميس 28 من هذا الشهر الميلادي، إلا أن الله شاء أن نبدأ الدورة يوم السبت في أول يوم من العام الهجري الجديد، وبعض إخواننا قد قدموا من أماكن بعيدة، بل إن بعض إخواننا قدموا من كندا، جزى الله الجميع خيرا. فحق الجميع علي أن أعتذر لهم فردا فردا. والحقيقة أني قد خرجت من المدينة في اليوم 27 من الشهر قادما إلى هذه الدورة، إلا أنه حصل مانع في الطريق ليس بيدي ولا بيد الإخوة، فتأخرنا في بداية الدورة. وكذلك من جهة عدد أيامها، فقد كان عدد أيامها 4، فصارت لهذا الظرف 3، يومان هنا في برمنغهام ويوم في لندن إن شاء الله عز وجل. هذا الاعتذار الأول. وأما الاعتذار الثاني فهو اعتذار عن تأثر صوتي. فالحقيقة أنا قرأت أن بريطانيا هذه الأيام حارة وفي حرارة والناس يشتكون من الحرارة، وعندما وصلت وجدت الأمر بردا بالنسبة لي. وصلت قبل ساعتين من الآن، عندما خرجت من المطار وجدت هواء باردا، فبحثت عن الصيف الذي يقولون فما وجدت، فتأثر صوتي قليلا، فأعتذر للإخوة عن هذا.
Then the Shaykh, may Allah protect and preserve him, he said, so this was the welcome. This was him welcoming all the brothers and sisters that have attended this conference. Then the Shaykh said, as for the apologies, then there are two apologies. Firstly, the Shaykh is apologizing to all the brothers and sisters for the changes that have taken place concerning this Dawra, conference. Firstly, the beginning, the start of this Dawra, and likewise the number of days of this conference. The Shaykh said he was supposed to start the Dawra on the first day, 28th of July, except that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala willed us to start today on Saturday, which is the first day of the new Hijri year. The Shaykh said some of our brothers have come from very far places. Some brothers have come from Canada, as far as Canada and other places. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward all of you. So the Shaykh said, the right of each and every one of you upon me, that I apologize to each and every one of you individually. And the Shaykh said, what the reality is, I actually left Medina on the 27th of July. Then on my way here, something happened, which was not in my hands and not in the hands of the brothers. So therefore, we were delayed in starting the conference. As for the number of days, the Shaykh said the conference again was supposed to be 4 days, 2 days in Birmingham and 2 days in London. But now it's going to be reduced to only 3 days, 2 days in Birmingham and a day in London, inshaAllah. As for the second apology, the Shaykh said, oh, I'd like to apologize for my voice. My voice, my sound has been affected. She said that before I came to England, I was hearing and I was reading that it's very, very hot here. Everyone's complaining of the heat. Because when I got here, this morning, a few hours ago, I found it cold. I got at the airport and I felt a cool breeze. And this is what has affected, or affected my sound or my voice.
معاشر الإخوة والأخوات، قد آثرنا في هذه الدورة أن نجعل هذه الدورة مجالس في مواضيع ذات أهمية كبرى في كل وقت، ولكن أهميتها قد ازدادت في هذه الأيام، حيث اخترنا أن تكون المجالس في التوحيد والسنة ومنهج السلف والأخلاق، وهذه المواضيع هي رأس المواضيع للمسلم في كل زمان، لكن في هذه الأيام ازدادت أهميتها، فالتوحيد والسنة ومنهج السلف في هذه الأيام تمر بمنعطف خطير، حيث نشط أهل الباطل في محاربة التوحيد والسنة ومنهج السلف، بل من أسف شديد تصدر فتاوى عن بعض من ينتسبون إلى العلم تقبح التوحيد وتدعو إلى ضده، وإذا نشط أهل الباطل في باطلهم فإن الواجب على أهل الحق أن يكونوا أكثر نشاطا. نحن بحاجة إلى أن نبين أهمية التوحيد وملامح التوحيد وأهمية السنة وتعظيم السنة، وأن نبين وجوب العمل بمنهج السلف الصالح رضوان الله عليهم أكثر من ذي قبل. وأعداء السلفية يتهمون السلفيين بعدم عنايتهم بالأخلاق، وكذبوا ورب الكعبة، فالسلفيون يتمسكون بالكتاب والسنة، والخلق الكريم كله في الكتاب والسنة، فكانت هذه المواضيع في هذه الأيام من الأهمية بمكان عظيم.
And the Shaykh Hafidhahullah Ta'ala, he continued, he said, "Dear brothers, this Dora, this conference, these gatherings of knowledge, then we have chosen specific subjects to talk about, subjects which are extremely important all times. However, in our time today, the importance has increased drastically. And this is why we have decided to talk about or make these gatherings about Tawheed, about Sunnah, about the methodology of the pious predecessors, and about mannerisms and good conduct." And the Shaykh said that these topics, these subjects, they are at the head of all topics which concern a Muslim. at all times. But nowadays, their importance has increased a lot. And this is because in our time today, Tawheed and Sunnah and the methodology of Salaf are passing through a very dangerous, or they are exposed to very dangerous affairs. Because the people of falsehood, they have become very active in waging war against Tawheed and waging war against the Sunnah and waging war against the Manhaj of the Salaf. But rather, the Shaykh said, unfortunately, we find even those people who issue fatawa, who issue religious verdicts, and who people return to for religious verdicts, we find even such people, they have started criticizing Tawheed and calling to that which is opposite of Tawheed. So if the people of falsehood have become active in their falsehood, then what is obligatory upon the people of the truth is that they should be even more active. So now we need to explain. We need to explain even now, even more so, about the importance of Tawheed. We need to explain to people the importance of the Sunnah and to honor the Sunnah. And we need to explain to people and clarify to them the obligation of following the methodology of the pious predecessors more than ever before. And the enemies of a Salafiyya, they accuse the Salafis of not showing any concern for akhlaq, for good manners. The Shaykh said, by Allah, they lie. Because the Salafiyun, they adhere to the book and the Sunnah. And good conduct and good mannerisms. All of that, all of good manners and good character that is found in the book and the Sunnah. This is why the Shaykh said that these days, talking about these topics is of utmost importance.
أيها الإخوة والأخوات، اخترت لهذا المجلس عنوانا هو من لزم السنة نجا. من لزم السنة نجا، وذلك أن المهلكات في الدنيا كثيرة، وأما طريق النجاة فواحد، طريق محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. الإنسان في هذه الدنيا يسير إلى الله، فإما أن يتقدم بالخير الذي يقدمه، وإما أن يتأخر بأن يقع في أيدي أعدائه، ولكن الجميع سيصيرون إلى الله. الإنسان في هذه الدنيا يعاديه الشيطان ويدعوه إلى ما يغضب الرحمن ويزين له الأهواء والشهوات وتعاديه نفسه الأمارة بالسوء تزخرف له متع الدنيا وإن كانت حراما ويعاديه أصدقاء السوء الذين يزهدونه في الخير ويدعونه إلى الشر ولا نجاة له من كل هذا بفضل الله عز وجل إلا بلزوم سنة محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم فمن لزم السنة نجا. أيضا الإنسان في دينه يدعوه أناس وأناس كل يدعو إلى طريقته فقد افترقت أمة محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وصار كل يدعو إلى ما يسير عليه ويقول إن الخير عندي والنجاة في لزوم سنة محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم فمن لزم السنة نجا. إن أردت أن تخرج من الدنيا سالما من شرورها فعليك بسنة محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. إن أردت أن يسلم لك دينك فعليك بسنة محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. ولا يغرنك كثرة الهلكة ولكن اعجب ممن نجا كيف نجا. لا يغرنك كثرة الناس على الباطل إنما العجب كيف أن هذا العبد من بين ملايين قد نجا. اصطفاه الله بأن جعله متمسكا بسنة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فكان من الناجين.
Shaykh Hafidhahullah Ta'ala, he continued, he said, "Dear respected brothers and sisters, this lesson, the first lecture, I chose the title, Whosoever Sticks to the Sunnah, Then He Shall Be Saved. He shall be safe." And this is because there are many things in this life that destroy a person. As for the path of salvation, it is only one. That is the way of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Because everyone in this dunya, in this life, whether he likes it or he doesn't, he's going to be traversing a path to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everyone traveling towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So either he's going to succeed due to the good that he has put forth, or he's going to fail. Or he's going to fail because he has fallen into the hands of his enemies. However, everyone is traveling towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's going towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And a person in this life, then the shaitan shows enmity towards everyone. Shaitan is his enemy, and he calls him to that which angers Ar-Rahman, and he beautifies for him doubts and desires. Likewise, a person in this life, he is opposed by his own self, which calls him to evil, and which beautifies for him the enjoyments of this life, even if they are unlawful and haram. And likewise, those people, evil people in this world, they also show enmity, and they also oppose a person by calling him away from the good and encouraging him and calling him towards evil. So we have all these things and all these people that show enmity to a person in this life, and they oppose him. So there is no salvation. There is no salvation except by adhering to the sunnah, by the mercy and the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So whosoever adheres to the sunnah, then he has attained salvation. Likewise, a person in his religion, many people will call him. Everyone is calling to his own way. The ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has become split and divided. Everyone is calling to that which he is upon. And he says, everyone says that the truth is with me, and the good is with me. So salvation lies in adhering to the sunnah. So whoever adheres to the sunnah shall attain salvation. So, dear brother and sister, if you desire to leave this dunya having attained safety from the evils of this dunya, then upon you is to adhere to the sunnah. If you desire to protect and preserve your religion, then upon you is to adhere to the sunnah. Don't be deceived by the many people that you see upon the path of destruction. But rather, what should amaze you is that you see the people who are safe and have attained salvation. How is it that out of millions of people, that these are the people that have attained salvation? This is what should astonish you and amaze you. How Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose these people amongst all people and made him a person who adheres to the sunnah. Therefore is from those who has attained salvation.
أيها الإخوة والأخوات، إن الله عز وجل قد أرسل رسوله محمدا صلى الله عليه وسلم إلى الناس أجمعين يدعوهم إليه ويعلمهم الكتاب والحكمة ويبين لهم ما نزل إليهم ويخرجهم من الظلمات إلى النور بإذن ربهم ويهديهم إلى صراط مستقيم هداية بيان وإعلام وأوجب على الناس أجمعين طاعته ومحبته صلى الله عليه وسلم. قال الله عز وجل: يا أيها الذين آمنوا أطيعوا الله وأطيعوا الرسول وأولي الأمر منكم. قال العلماء: قال الله عز وجل يا أيها الذين آمنوا أطيعوا الله ففرض عليهم فرضا لازما أن يطيعوه سبحانه وقال وأطيعوا الرسول فكرر الفعل لأن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يطاع في كل ما جاء به وطاعته من طاعة الله. تكرار الفعل فائدته أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لا يستثنى من طاعته شيء، بل كل ما ثبت عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يطاع فيه. وذلك قال الله وأولي الأمر منكم، ما قال وأطيعوا أولي الأمر منكم، ما كرر الفعل هنا، لأن أولي الأمر من الأمراء والعلماء لا يطاعون مطلقا في كل ما يقولون، وإنما ذلك مقيد بغير معصية الله. إذن يا عبد الله يا مؤمن، يجب عليك أن تطيع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم في كل ما جاء عنه مما ثبت عنه صلى الله عليه وسلم. وقال الله عز وجل وإن تطيعوه تهتدوا، فالهداية في طاعته صلى الله عليه وسلم. وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى أكون أحب إليه من والده وولده والناس أجمعين. لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى أكون أحب إليه من والده وولده والناس أجمعين. نعم، الوالد يحب ولده، لكن يجب عليه أن يكون حبه لرسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أعظم من حبه لولده. فإذا تعارض حبه لولده مع حبه لرسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قدم حب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. الولد يحب أباه ويحب أمه، لكن يجب عليه أن يكون حبه لرسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أعظم من حبه لوالديه. نعم، الزوجة تحب زوجها، وهذا من مكارم المسلمات، لكن يجب عليها أن يكون حبها لرسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أعظم من حبها لزوجها. الزوج يحب زوجته، لكن يجب عليه أن يكون حبه لرسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أعظم من حبه لزوجته. الإنسان يحب نفسه، لكن يجب عليه أن يكون حبه لرسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أعظم من حبه لنفسه. ولا تكون طاعة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إلا بتعظيم سنته والعمل بها. ومن محبته صلى الله عليه وسلم أن يحب المؤمن سنته وأن يعمل بها.
Shaykh Hafidhahullah Ta'ala, he continues, he says, Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala sent Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam to all of mankind. hold them to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to teach them the book and the hikmah, and to clarify to them that which has been revealed and sent down to them. And to take them out of darkness into light by the permission of their Lord. And to guide them to the straight path. The guidance, this guidance here, as the Shaykh explained, is the guidance of bayan, the guidance of clarifying and explaining and teaching. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made it obligatory upon everyone to obey the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and to love him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O you who believe, obey Allah and obey the Messenger and those in authority over you. And the scholars have mentioned here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ati'ullah. O you who believe, obey Allah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made this an obligation that everyone obeys him. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, wa ati'ur rasul, and obey the messenger. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this ayah, he repeats the verb ati'u, ati'u twice. Once Ati'ullah, and the second time with Ati'ur Rasul. The verb is repeated, and this is because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is to be obeyed in everything that he came with. And that obedience to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is from obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the benefit of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala repeating the verb here, Ati'u. That the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is to be obeyed in everything. This is why when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he spoke about those who are in authority over us, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not repeat the verb ati'u again, the third time. He just said, ati'u Allah wa ati'u Rasul wa ulil amri minkum. Obey Allah and obey the messenger and those in authority over you. This is because those who are in authority over us from the scholars and from the rulers, then they are not to be obeyed in everything unrestrictedly, in everything they say or they do. But rather, obedience to them is restricted to that which does not contain disobedience to Allah or His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So dear brother and sister, it is obligatory upon you to obey the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in everything that has been authentically established from him. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِن تُطِيعُهُ تَحْتَدُ. If you were to obey him, then you will be guided. So guidance is in the obedience of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in a hadith that none of you will truly believe until I am more beloved to him than his parents, his children, the whole of mankind. So yes, of course, parents, they love their children. However, their love for the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam should be more. So if there's a conflict between their love for their children and their love for the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then they must give precedence to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and love them more than their children. Love him sallallahu alaihi wasallam more than their children. And likewise the parents. A child, he loves his parents. The same applies here. That he must love the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he or she must love the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam more than his parents. And Likewise, a wife, she loves her husband, vice versa. And in each scenario, the love that they have for each other must be less than the love they have for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And also a person, he loves himself. Again, the love that he has for the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam must be greater than the love he has for himself. And the obedience to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam can only be actualized and manifested by honoring and respecting and showing great concern for the sunnah and by acting upon the sunnah. And from loving the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is that a person, he loves the sunnah and he acts upon the sunnah.
أيها الإخوة والأخوات، السنة تطلق في لسان العلماء على أنحاء. الأول، السنة المرادفة للمستحب والمندوب، أي ما يثاب فاعله ولا يعاقب تاركه، وهي تقابل المكروه، وهي حكم من الأحكام التكليفية. مثلا يقول العلماء: رفع اليدين عند تكبيرة الإحرام وعند الركوع وعند الرفع منه سنة. يعني أنه إذا فعلها المسلم زاد أجر صلاته، لكن لو تركها لا يعاقب، لكن سيفوته الأجر العظيم. والثاني، الدليل من الوحي غير المتلو. الدليل من الوحي غير المتلو، يعني هذا الدليل غير المتلو. فالوحي كما تعلمون متلو وغير متلو. متلو هو القرآن، وغير متلو وهو السنة، وهي الحكمة كما يقولون: الدليل من الكتاب كذا ومن السنة كذا. والثالث، هدي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وطريقته، أي كل ما ثبت عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم من قول أو فعل أو تقرير كله يسمى سنة، فهو عام شامل. والرابع من معاني السنة في لسان العلماء: المشروع من العبادات. ويقابل السنة هنا البدعة، يقابل السنة هنا البدعة. فالمشروع من العبادات سنة، صيام شهر الله المحرم سنة، أن تكثر من الصيام في شهر الله المحرم، هذا الشهر الذي بدأنا اليوم أول أيامه سنة، أن تصوم يوم عاشوراء من هذا الشهر سنة، هذه عبادة مشروعة. ويقابلها البدعة التي لم تشرع، أن تصوم أول يوم من محرم لأنه أول يوم من السنة، ليس لأنه من محرم لا، وإنما لأنه أول يوم من السنة، هذا بدعة. إذن السنة تأتي بمعنى المشروع من العبادات ويقابلها البدعة. والمعنى الخامس للسنة في لسان العلماء طريقة الخلفاء الراشدين، الخلفاء الأربعة طريقتهم أيضا تسمى سنة. نعم هي سنة شرعية، لأن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال: فعليكم بسنتي وسنة الخلفاء المهديين. وسيأتي إن شاء الله الكلام عن هذا الحديث. نعم. طبعا كل هذه المعاني يا إخوة تدخل في قولنا من لزم السنة فاز ونجا، من لزم السنة فاز ونجا. نعم.
الشيخ حفظه الله تعالى said, dear brothers and sisters, that the word sunnah has different meanings in the religion. So firstly, the word sunnah is synonymous to something, or it means something that is mustahab, recommended. The act of worship which is recommended, act that if a person was to do it, he will be rewarded for it, and if he was not to do it, then he should not be punished for it. And what directly opposes this meaning of the sunnah here, this meaning of the sunnah here, is makruh, that which is disliked. So this is from the rulings, the taklifiyya, ahkam taklifiyya. Sunnah here, the meaning of sunnah, is a ruling which we are burdened with. The Shaykh said, for example, raising your hands while you are praying, raising your hands with the opening takbir, and then raise your hands when you go into ruku, and then raise your hands when you come out of ruku. This act here is a sunnah. If a person does it, then the reward that he receives for his prayer will increase. And if he doesn't do it, he will not be punished, but he will miss out on great reward. This is the first meaning of sunnah. The second meaning of sunnah is dalil, evidence. Evidence from revelation, which it is evidence from revelation which is not recited. That's the second meaning of sunnah. Because wahi, revelation, from it is that which is recited, which is the Quran. That which is not recited, that is a sunnah. Like for example, they say that dalil, evidence from the book, from the kitab, is such and such. Evidence from the sunnah is such and such. The third meaning of sunnah, the guidance of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his way, meaning everything which has been firmly established from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in terms of statements or actions or approvals, then all of this is included in this meaning of the word sunnah. The fourth meaning the Shaykh mentioned, hafidhahullah, is sunnah. It means that which is act, legislated act of worship. Sunnah means a legislated act of worship. And what directly opposes this meaning of sunnah is the word bid'ah, innovations. So anything which is legislated from acts of worship, then we call it sunnah. So fasting, this month that we are in today we began the month of Muharram. Fasting the month of Muharram is a sunnah. To increase in fasting in this month is sunnah. Fasting on the day of Ashura from this month is sunnah, is an act of worship which is legislated. And what directly opposes this, as we mentioned, is bid'ah, innovations. If a person was to now fast the first day of this month of Muharram with the intention that it is the first day of the Islamic year, of the new Islamic year, not with the intention that it is the month of Muharram, then this fasting of his is a bid'ah. It is an innovation. So this is the fourth meaning that the Shaykh mentioned, the meaning of sunnah. The fourth meaning of the sunnah is are legislated acts of worship. And the fifth and final meaning that the Shaykh mentioned, that the word sunnah, it means the way of the rightly guided khalifas, the four khalifas. Their way is sunnah. Their way is called sunnah. And it is a legislated sunnah. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, upon you is to adhere to my sunnah and the sunnah of the rightly guided khalifas. So the Shaykh finished by saying that all these meanings of sunnah, these five meanings of sunnah that we have mentioned, all of them are included in the title of today's talk, which is whosoever adheres to and sticks to the sunnah, then he shall be successful and he shall attain salvation.
إخوة يعني في تحديد الوقت طلبوا مني أن نتوقف في 3:30 تستريح نصف ساعة، فهل تعبتم أو نواصل؟ طيب نكمل إلى أن يأتي وقت الصلاة. طيب نحن سنستمر إن شاء الله ما دمتم ما تعبتم، الحق لكم، إن قلتم لي قف سأقف، وإذا قلتم واصل أنا أريد أن أواصل. أيها الإخوة، أمر السنة كريم ومقامها عظيم، فيجب على المؤمن والمؤمنة أن يعظمها وأن يقدمها. فيجب على المؤمن أن يعتقد أن الخير له في السنة، وأن يقدم السنة على قول كل أحد من الناس. قال الله عز وجل: وما كان لمؤمن ولا مؤمنة إذا قضى الله ورسوله أمرا أن يكون لهم الخيرة من أمرهم. السنة إذا كانت على سبيل الإلزام فاعلم أن الخير كله فيها. إذا كانت على سبيل الإلزام اعلم يقينا أن الخير كله فيها. فالخير مثلا في أن يعفي الرجل لحيته، والله إن الخير للرجل أن يعفي لحيته وأن لا يحلق لحيته، وهذه سنة على سبيل الإلزام. وإذا لم تكن على سبيل الإلزام فاعلم أن الخير في فعلها، وأن فعلها خير لك من تركها. إذن السنة دائما فيها خير. إذا كانت على سبيل الإلزام فالخير كله فيها، وإذا لم تكن على سبيل الإلزام ففعلها خير لك من تركها. وَ ومن أراد الفوز عند لقاء الله، من آمن بالله واليوم الآخر وآمن أنه سيلقى الله وأن الناس عند لقاء الله منهم شقي وسعيد، وأراد أن يكون سعيدا عند لقاء الله، فليتأسى برسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. والتأسي برسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يكون بمعرفة سنته ولزومها. إذا أردت أن تكون سعيدا عند لقاء الله فالزم سنة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. ومن أراد أن يكون على دين سليم قويم على صراط مستقيم فعليه بسنة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. قال ربنا سبحانه وتعالى: لقد كان لكم في رسول الله أسوة حسنة لمن كان يرجو الله واليوم الآخر وذكر الله كثيرا. لمن كان يرجو الله واليوم الآخر ويريد أن يكون من الفائزين السعداء عند لقاء الله، وذكر الله كثيرا أي من أراد أن يكون على دين قوي، فليتأس برسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. مخالفة أمر رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لا تقود إلى خير. قال الله عز وجل: فليحذر الذين يخالفون عن أمره أن تصيبهم فتنة أو يصيبهم عذاب أليم. فليحذر الذين يخالفون عن أمره، أمر من؟ أمر محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، أن تصيبهم فتنة أو يصيبهم عذاب أليم. سبحان الله يا إخوة، اسمعوا هذه القصة. جاء رجل إلى الإمام مالك رحمه الله فقال: يا أبا عبد الله، أريد أن أحرم من عند القبر. ما يريد أن يحرم من ذي الحليفة من الميقات، يريد أن يحرم من عند قبر رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. فقال له مالك: لا تفعل، فإني أخاف عليك الفتنة. فقال الرجل بقصر نظره: وأي فتنة؟ وإنما هي خطوات أزيدها في سبيل الله. كيف تخاف علي الفتنة؟ أنا أزيد في سبيل الله. فقال: وأي فتنة أعظم من أن تظن أنك سبقت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم؟ الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم ما أحرم من بيته، أحرم من ذو الحليفة، فأنت إذا فعلت ستظن أنك فعلت شيئا أفضل. وهذه هي الفتنة. إذن قاعدة أيها الإخوة والأخوات: مخالفة أمر رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لا تقود إلى خير. ومفهوم هذا أن طاعة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم تقود إلى كل خير.
Then the Shaykh حفظه الله تعالى said that the reward of sunnah is great and its status is great, that the sunnah occupies a great and tremendous status. So it is obligatory upon every believer, therefore, to honor and to respect the sunnah, to give it precedence, and to place it before every other thing. It is obligatory upon a believer that he gives precedence to the statements of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam over and above any other person. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, it is not befitting for a believing man or woman that once Allah and His Messenger have decreed a certain matter, that they have any choice in it. And sunnah, if it is a sunnah which is obligatory, then know with certainty that all good is in following this sunnah. So for example, a man used to grow his beard and not shave it. Because in growing your beard and not shaving it, in it is all goodness. So this sunnah is one which is obligatory. It's a sunnah from the ways of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but it is a sunnah which is obligatory. As for a sunnah which is not obligatory, then likewise know with certainty that acting upon it is all goodness. That all goodness is in acting upon this sunnah. And it is better to act upon this sunnah than to leave it. So sunnah, all of it is good. Sunnah is always good. Whether it is a sunnah which is obligatory, then there's no doubt that doing it is always good. If it's a sunnah which is not obligatory, then there is no doubt that doing this sunnah, acting upon this sunnah, is better than not acting upon it. So whosoever wants to be successful when he meets Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who believes in Allah and the last day, when he meets Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the day he meets Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there are those people who will be miserable, and there are those people who will be happy. So if he wants to be from those people who shall be happy when they meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then he should follow the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and follow his example. And following the example of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam can only be attained by knowing the sunnah, having knowledge of the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and then acting upon it. So if you want to imitate the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then first learn about his sunnah and then act upon it and adhere to it. And likewise, if a person, if he wants to be successful and happy when he meets Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then let him adhere to the sunnah. If a person wants his religion to be safe and sound and correct, and he wants to be upon the straight path, then let him follow the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, indeed, for you in the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the best of examples for the one who hopes in the meeting with Allah, and he hopes in the last day, and he remembers Allah much. So whosoever hopes in the meeting of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and hopes in the last day, and he wants to be successful and happy when he meets Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then let him follow the sunnah. Allah says, وَذَكَرَ اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا. And the one who remembers Allah much, meaning that he wants to be upon the correct religion. So whosoever wants to be successful in the hereafter, happy when he meets Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he wants to be upon the correct religion, then let him adhere to the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then the Shaykh Hafidhahullah, he said, as for opposing the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then it does not lead to any good. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, then let those who oppose his command be warned that a fitna should befall them or a painful punishment. So whosoever opposes the command of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then he should be warned that a fitna, a trial and a tribulation shall befall him, or a painful punishment. The Shaykh said, look at this amazing story of Imam Malik, rahimahullah. A man, he came to Imam Malik, and he said, oh, Aba Abdullah, I want to assume ihram at the grave of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I mean, I don't want to assume my ihram from the miqat, Dhul Hulayfa. Rather, I want to assume ihram from the grave, at the grave. The Imam Malik rahimahullah said, don't do this. If you do this, I fear for you fitna. I fear a trial for you, a tribulation shall befall you. This man, due to his short-sightedness, lack of knowledge, he said, what fitna is going to befall me? What fitna can possibly befall me? It's just extra distance which I'm adding in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's all I'm doing. Imam Malik rahimahullah, he replied, he said, what fitna, what calamity and trial can be greater than thinking or believing that you have outdone the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he surely did not assume ihram from his house. He assumed it from the miqat. So you basically are saying that what you have done is better than what the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has done. What greater fitna can there be than this? So the qaida, the principle is that opposing the command of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it does not lead to any good. It leads to evil. So what can be understood from this is that obeying the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it leads to all good.
أيها الإخوة والأخوات، السنة فيها النجاة، وأهل السنة هم أهل الحق بشهادة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. فعن العرباض بن سارية رضي الله عنه قال: وعظنا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم موعظة وجلت منها القلوب وذرفت منها العيون، فقلنا يا رسول الله كأنها موعظة مودع فأوصنا. فقال صلى الله عليه وسلم: أوصيكم بتقوى الله والسمع والطاعة، وإن تأمر عليكم عبد فإنه من يعش منكم فسيرى اختلافا كثيرا، فعليكم بسنتي وسنة الخلفاء الراشدين المهديين، تمسكوا بها وعضوا عليها بالنواجذ، وإياكم ومحدثات الأمور، فإن كل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة. سبحان الله، هذا الحديث كنز من كنوز العلم. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم صلى بأصحابه صلاة الفجر يوما، ثم أقبل عليهم بوجهه فوعظهم موعظة بليغة، وكلام النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بليغ، لكنه هذه المرة زاد في البلاغة، وجلت منها القلوب وذرفت منها العيون، وهذا هو الخشوع الحقيقي، وجل القلب ودمع العين. ليس الخشوع أن تدمع العين والقلب غافل، وإنما الدمع في الخشوع أثر وجل القلب. فقالوا يا رسول الله كأنها موعظة مودع فأوصنا. وهذا هو المنهج الشرعي ومنهج السلف الصالح مع العلم، أن يطلب الإنسان الزيادة في العلم، وقل رب زدني علما. الصحابة رضوان الله عليهم لما رأوا بلاغة الموعظة قالوا زدنا يا رسول الله أوصنا. ولا يزال المؤمن بخير ما طلب الزيادة في العلم. والعلم وقته العمر كله إلى أن يموت الإنسان. والعلماء يا إخوة يقولون لن ينال العلم ملول، لن ينال العلم ملول. الإنسان الذي يمل وإذا جلس قليلا يريد أن يخرج ولا يستمع ولا يحب الزيادة، هذا لن ينال العلم. العلم يحتاج إلى صبر ومصابرة وطلب الزيادة. الشاهد أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أوصاهم، ومن ضمن وصيته فإنه من يعش منكم بعدي فسيرى اختلافا كثيرا. وقد وقع الاختلاف والله في أمة محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، ولا يزال الخلاف يتوسع كلما ابتعدنا عن زمن النبوة. طيب من نجا؟ من هم الذين على الحق؟ ما علامة أهل الحق؟ فعليكم بسنتي، ولازم هذا عليكم بمن يدعوكم إلى سنتي. إلزموا من يدعوكم إلى سنتي. ومفهوم هذا احذروا من الدعاة من لا ترى في كلامه سنة، من يخالف السنة. فعليكم بسنتي وسنة الخلفاء الراشدين المهديين. هؤلاء الخلفاء الأربعة إلزموا سنتهم، وهذا أصل سيأتينا إن شاء الله في اتباع منهج السلف. فهؤلاء هم أهل الحق الذين يدعونك إلى السنة، الذين يتمسكون بالسنة. وإياكم ومحدثات الأمور، احذروا من يأتيكم بأمور محدثة فإنه بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة. فالنجاة في سنة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. نعم.
شيخ حفظه الله تعالى، he continues and he says that in sunnah there is salvation. And the people of sunnah, then they are the people of truth. This is by the testimony of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as comes in the hadith of Al-Irbad ibn Sariya radiyallahu an, who said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he delivered very effective admonition. He gave us his admonition, or sermon that he delivered. It was very effective. And due to it being very effective, our hearts were filled with fear and our eyes shed tears. So we said, O Messenger of Allah, it is as if this is an admonition of a person who is bidding farewell. So give us some advice. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam responded and said, I command you, I order you to fear Allah and to hear and to obey, even if a slave becomes your leader. Whosoever amongst you, whosoever from amongst you lives long after me, then he will see much differing. So stick to my sunnah and to the sunnah of the rightly guided khalifas. Hold on to it tight and bite onto it with your molar teeth. And beware of every newly invented matter. For every newly invented matter is an innovation. And every innovation is misguidance. So this hadith is a tremendous hadith. And it is in fact a treasure. As the Shaykh Hafizullah said, it's a treasure from the treasures of knowledge. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one day he prayed Fajr. He led his Sahaba, he led the Sahaba in the Fajr prayer. And upon completion, he turned towards his Sahaba and he delivered this very effective and eloquent admonishment. And all of the speech of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is eloquent. And all his speech is effective. On this occasion, it was the eloquence and the effectiveness had increased. This is why the hearts were affected. And this is why they shed tears. This is the khushu haqiqi. This is the true humility and humbleness and submission. The khushu, tranquility and humility and humbleness, is not that your eyes shed tears while your heart is inattentive. This is not true khushu'. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Sahaba said it is as if this is a speech, an admonition of a person who is bidding farewell. So give us advice. The Shaykh said, Hafidhullah, that this is the way, this is the correct way, and this is the manhaj and the way of the Salaf in regards to knowledge. That a person strives to increase in knowledge. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَقُلْ رَبِّ زِدْنِ إِلْمًا. My Lord, increase me in knowledge. So when the Sahaba, they saw the effectiveness and the eloquence of this speech of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they said to him, advise us, give us advice, increase us. There is no doubt that as long as a person continues to gain more knowledge, then he shall remain upon goodness. And Knowledge, a person must gain knowledge and keep increasing a knowledge until he dies. That's why the scholars, they say that a person who quickly gives up and gets bored and gets fed up, this kind of person can never gain knowledge. A person who gets bored, fed up, and then he leaves, goes out, does not continue, and he doesn't want to increase in knowledge, then he's not going to attain knowledge. A person wants to attain knowledge, he must remain patient, and he must strive, and he must do his best to increase in knowledge. The point here is that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he advised them, and he told them that whoever lives long amongst you after me, then he's going to see much different. And there is no doubt that much differing in the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam has indeed occurred. In fact, the more we move away from the time of prophethood, the more differing we shall see in the ummah. So what is the solution? What is the salvation? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Alaykum bi sunnati, adhere to my sunnah." And what this necessitates, therefore, that you also, as well as adhering and sticking to the sunnah of the Prophet, you adhere and you stick with those who call you to the sunnah. And what we can deduce and understand from this, that then at the same time, we must be cautious of those people who have opposed the sunnah and who call us away from the sunnah. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam continued and he said, "So stick to my sunnah and the sunnah of the rightly guided khalifas who are four. Adhere and stick to their sunnah." And this sticking to the sunnah of the four rightly khalifas, then this is a principle, the principles of following the salaf, inshallah, which we shall talk about later. So the people of the haq, the people of the truth, they are the ones, they call to the truth, and they call to the sunnah, and the right path. And at the end, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Beware of every newly invented matter, for every newly invented matter is a bid'ah, is an innovation, and every innovation is in the hellfire." So the point here is that salvation, it lies in sticking to the sunnah.
أيها الإخوة والأخوات، تعليم السنة وتعلم السنة والتمسك بالسنة أعلى مراتب الجهاد في سبيل الله في هذا الزمان، وهو جهاد ليس خاصا بالرجل، بل يجاهد في هذا الباب الرجل وتجاهد في هذا الباب المرأة. قال أبو عبيد القاسم بن سلام: "المتبع للسنة كالقابض على الجمر، وهو اليوم عندي أفضل من الضرب بالسيوف في سبيل الله." هذا في زمن أبي عبيد، فكيف بزمننا هذا؟ لا شك يا معاشر الفضلاء أن الذي يتمسك بالسنة في هذا الزمان مجاهد في سبيل الله، له أجر الجهاد في سبيل الله. واعلموا أيها الإخوة أن من لم يعظم سنة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم، ومن استهزأ بها أو وصفها بكونها قشورا، يوشك أن يظلم قلبه، ويوشك أن يعجل له الله العقوبة في الدنيا. والله من لا يعظم السنة تجد في قلبه ظلمة، وتجد على كلامه ظلمة، ولو زين الكلام، ولو زخرف الكلام، ويوشك أن يعجل الله العقوبة لمن يستهزئ بسنة رسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم. جاء عن سلمة بن الأكوع رضي الله عنه أن رجلا أكل عند رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بشماله، فقال: كل بيمينك. قال: لا أستطيع. قال: لا استطعت، ما منعه إلا الكبر. قال رضي الله عنه: فما رفعها إلى فيه. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول له: قل بيمينك. فقال: لا أستطيع. وهو يستطيع، لكنه تكبر على السنة. قال العلماء: وهذا من المنافقين، تكبر على السنة. فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: لا استطعت. فعاقبه الله أنه ما استطاع بعد أن يرفع يمينه إلى فيه. وعن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أنه قال: بينما رجل يتبختر في بردين خسف الله به الأرض فهو يتجلجل فيها إلى يوم القيامة. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يخبر، فقال له فتى: يا أبا هريرة، أهكذا كان يمشي ذلك الفتى الذي خسف به؟ كالمستهزئ. قال الراوي: فعثر عثرة كاد أن يتكسر منها. هذا الفتى لما قال هكذا ويصف الفعل كالمستهزئ، عثر وسقط سقطة كاد أن يتكسر منها. وجاء رجل إلى سعيد بن المسيب يودعه بحج أو عمرة، يريد أن يخرج إلى حج أو عمرة. جاء له في المسجد وقد أذن المؤذن وهو يودعه ويريد أن يخرج، فقال له سعيد: لا تبرح حتى تصلي، لا تخرج من المسجد حتى تصلي، فإن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال: لا يخرج بعد النداء من المسجد إلا منافق، إلا رجل أخرجته حاجة وهو يريد الرجعة إلى المسجد. فقال الرجل: إن أصحابي بالحرة. فخرج، ما امتثل للحديث، خرج. فلم يزل سعيد يذكره، يعني يسأل عنه، يتوقع أنه سيصيبه شيء لأنه لم يعمل بالسنة. قال: حتى أخبر أنه وقع عن راحلته فانكسرت فخذه. عاجله الله بعقوبة. وقد جاء عن أبي عبد الله محمد بن إسماعيل التيمي أنه قال: قرأت في بعض الحكايات لم يذكر لها إسناد أن بعض المبتدعة يعني الذين لا يعظمون السنة حين سمع قول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا استيقظ أحدكم من نومه فلا يغمس يده في الإناء حتى يغسلها فإنه لا يدري أين باتت يده. قال ذلك المبتدع على سبيل التهكم، أنا أدري أين باتت يدي، باتت في الفراش. يعني أين ستبات يدي؟ باتت في الفراش كالمستهزئ بالحديث. قالوا فأصبح وقد أدخل يده في دبره. عاقبه الله. وجاء عن أبي يحيى الساجي قال كنا نمشي في أزقة البصرة فأسرعنا المشي، كنا نمشي في بعض أزقة البصرة إلى باب بعض المحدثين فأسرعنا المشي، يعني نسير إلى طلب العلم، فأسرعنا المشي ومعنا شاب ماجن فقال مستهزئا ارفعوا أرجلكم عن أجنحة الملائكة لا تكسروها، لأن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أخبر أن الملائكة تضع أجنحتها لطالب العلم رضا بما يصنع، فهذا يستهزئ ويقول ارفعوا أرجلكم عن أجنحة الملائكة لا تكسروها. قال فلم يزل من موضعه حتى جفت رجلاه وسقط، يعني شل في مكانه، أصابه الشلل في مكانه. وقد ذكر العلماء أن إسناد هذه القصة من أصح الأسانيد، فرواتها أعلام أئمة. الشاهد يا إخوة أن من لم يعظم السنة يعاقب بظلمة قلبه وبعدم النور في قوله، ويوشك أن يعاجله الله بعقوبة في الدنيا قبل الآخرة. وهذا من عظيم شأن سنة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم.
Shaykh Hafidahullah Ta'ala, he continues and he says that teaching the sunnah and learning the sunnah and holding on to the sunnah, this is from the greatest levels of jihad in our time today. And this jihad is not specific to men. It applies to both men and the women. And Abu Ubaid Al-Qasi ibn Salam rahimahullah, he said the one who follows the sunnah is like the one who holds onto hot coal, and he is today with me, yani in my opinion, he is today better than those who fight jihad with the swords. This, as the Shaykh said, this was in his time. So how about our time today? There is no doubt that the one who holds on to the Sunnah in our time today, then for him is the reward of performing jihad in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And whoever does not honor the Sunnah, and whosoever mocks the sunnah, then it is very possible that his heart shall become completely black and dark, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will punish him in this life. Whoever does not honor the sunnah, then in his heart is darkness, in his speech is darkness, even if he tries to beautify his speech. And it is very possible that the time is very close for him that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will punish him in this life for mocking the sunnah and for not honoring and respecting the sunnah. The companion Salama ibn al-Aqwa radiyallahu an, he said a man was eating in the presence of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was eating with his left hand. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him, eat with your right hand. And he said, I cannot. He said, I cannot. Because he was proud and arrogant. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him, may you never be able to eat with your right hand. And the one who narrated this hadith, he said that this person, he was never after this, was never able to raise his right hand to his mouth again. So when he said that I cannot, of course he could. He had the ability to do so, but he was too arrogant, and too proud to follow the sunnah. As the scholars have mentioned, that this he was from the munafiqun. He was from hypocrites. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made dua. He said, may you never be able to do it. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala punished him. After that, he was never able to raise his right hand to his mouth. Abu Huraira radiyallahu an, he said, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, while a man, he was walking arrogantly and in a proud manner, two garments he was wearing, and he was, due to that, he was walking arrogantly. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala caused the earth to swallow him, and he continues to go deeper and deeper until Yawm al-Qiyamah. So young man, he said to Abu Huraira radiyallahu anhu, oh Abu Huraira, was he walking like this? He made some gestures trying to mock the hadith, trying to mock what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, was the man who got swallowed up by the earth walking like this? And then the Rawi, the narrator of this hadith, he said, this man, this very same man who made these moves and these gestures, was mocking, he fell. He stumbled and he fell, and he was almost about to break something in his body. And also a man, he came to Sa'id al-Musayyib. Bidding him farewell, he was going to Hajj, he was going to Umrah, he came to say his goodbyes. And Sayyid al-Musayyib rahimahullah, he was in the masjid and the adhan had been called. So Sayyid said to him, don't now exit the masjid until you've prayed. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said that no one exits the masjid after hearing the call to the prayer except a hypocrite. Except if a person has a need, then go and fulfill it while having the intention of returning to the masjid. So this person, he said to Sa'id rahimahullah, he said to him, my companions are waiting in a certain place. And he exited. He didn't follow this hadith. He did not implement this hadith. He exited. So Sayyidina Musayyib, he kept asking about this man because he feared for him. Sayyidina Musayyib, he knew that this man, he has now opposed the statement of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he was worried for him. He kept asking about him. What has happened to him? Has anything happened to him? Then he found out that this person, he fell from his riding animal and he broke his thigh. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he punished him in this dunya. Also in a narration from Abu Abdullah At-Taymi, he said that I read some narrations, some of the innovators, when they heard the saying of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that when one of you wakes up, then do not put your hand in a vessel until he has washed his hand, because he doesn't know where his hand was during the night. He doesn't know what happened to his hand during the night, where it was. So this innovator said in reply, he was mocking here out of mockery. He said, I know where my hand was last night. My hand was in my bed. Of course your hand's only been in the bed, but he was mocking the sunnah. So when this person woke up, when this person woke up, he found his hand in his private part. Another narration from Yahya As-Saji, he said that we were walking in Basra and we were going to the people of Hadith. To the Muhaddithun. They were walking and to gain knowledge. So we started walking fast. And amongst us was a sinful, there was a youth, a young man amongst us. And he said, when we start walking fast, he said, raise your feet, so that you do not break the wings of the angels. Because as you know, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said that the angels, when a person is gaining knowledge, the angels, they lower their wings for him due to what he is doing. So this person, out of mocking this hadith, he said, raise your legs, raise your feet, so you don't break the wings that the angels have lowered. And so this person, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala punished him for this mockery. And in that very same place, he became paralyzed and he fell. Became paralyzed and he fell. And the scholars have mentioned that the chain of narration, the isnad of this qissa, of this story, is from the most authentic chain of narration. Those who narrated this story are well-known a'imma, imams. The point here, the Shaykh Hafidhullah keeps reiterating, may Allah reward him, is that whosoever does not honor the sunnah, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will punish him. Or he shall be punished by way of his heart becoming dark and there being no nur and no light in his statements. And it is feared for him that Allah will very soon punish him in this dunya. This is all due to the lofty status that the sunnah occupies.
أيها الإخوة والأخوات، لعلنا نقف عند هذا المقطع للراحة والصلاة إن شاء الله، صلاة العصر، ثم نرجع إن شاء الله في الوقت الذي يعلن لكم عنه الإخوة إن شاء الله.
The Shaykh Hafidhullah, he said, we'll stop here, we'll take a break, and inshallah we'll pray Asr, and then we'll come back to the next lecture.